good afternoon. Let's sing the chorus, I've Got a River of Life, page 427.
Give thanks on page 593 as Sister Rachel's class comes up.
Jesus Christ. Let's sing. Blessed be.
One second. Little Luke has something for us at Brother Terrence's request, and we're very proud of him that he knows this at such a young age. So we're going to let him go ahead.
Let us sing, Blessed Be the Lord God Almighty, page 6.
Good afternoon. Sister Cletus Smallwood, she said to please pray for Shirley. So please remember that and remember all the other prayer requests too. And let's all unspoken requests, please raise your hand. Let's stand. Let's all go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, I thank you for this day, and I thank you for everything you've done for us, and I pray that you please answer all the prayer requests and help Brother Darrell as he preaches this afternoon. And please forgive us of all of our sins in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing happy birthday to all the Sister Charlotte's birthday. Sister Charlotte's birthday.
Oh, and Terrence. You can't forget Terrence.
Oh, and Terrence's birthday. Let's all sing.
Happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday.
Has a testimony.
This is not going to be a quick one. Yeah, sit down.
I'll go as quick as I can. Turn on the PowerPoint, please. Can y'all see that pretty good? Can you turn off the lights? I can't see that at all. All right, that's a little better. So this is my prayer closet, 45-ton prayer closet. I'll go ahead and skip to the end and tell you all the result. The other day I had my first wreck, and everybody turned out fine, perfect, perfectly fine by the grace of God. But I got to give a long backstory to it. I'll be as brief as I can, but for you to understand the background here. So, first off, okay, so what happens is I drive every day to work, 15 minutes to work, clock in, get a truck, get a trailer, drive out to the farm, back up to the chicken house. This is just one of our typical farms in South Carolina. All right, we have a lot in South Carolina and North Georgia and all over. I back up to the house, the crew takes over from there, loading the chickens onto the trailer with this hydrostatic loader. The guys stand in the house, they pick up the chickens, load them in the cages. Now, three big problems, inherent dangers with driving these trucks is, number one, the cages weigh 700 pounds empty. They're solid steel. So a loaded cage like the one, can y'all see that, that he's raising up onto the truck weighs about the weight of a small car, 22 to 23 or 2,400 pounds. So I'm hauling from Georgia, usually I haul about 20 cages at a time, so I got about 20 cars, plus the weight of my truck and trailer. The other day when I had the wreck, I weighed 86,500 pounds. All right. Second problem, we're not only heavy, but we're very top heavy. Unlike conventional trailers, you know, like Brother Joe Silas drives, you know, there's in a box trailer, usually the load is sitting on pallets on the floor, on the deck. So it goes up to maybe yay high. Ours is distributed all the way up to the very top. So we're extremely top heavy, which means in a wreck, if you swerve, you're very likely to turn over. Problem number three, these doors, y'all probably can't see that, but each compartment, there's 15 compartments on each cage. And the doors only take about 5 pounds of pressure to open. It makes them easy to unload at the plant. They set them on a hydraulic dumper, turns the cage over, the chickens fall out. 5 pounds to open each door, and there's 140 pounds of chickens behind each door. So if you stop really hard, chickens slide forward, doors come open, chickens go everywhere on the highway. Three big problems with driving these trucks. It's okay if nobody pulls out in front of you. All right, well, go on to the next slide, please. This is just a closer-up view of the truck. Next slide. So this is where the wreck happened the other day. 7 miles north from here on Georgia 365. Y'all familiar with Wilbanks Road? Maybe some of y'all? Well, it's just south of Baldwin, the city of Baldwin. There's a Dairy Queen on that side of the road. This is southbound 365, northbound, just 7 miles north of here. Dairy Queen's over here. Somewhere back over this way is the Hartford House and all that. All right, I was headed southbound on 365 at 65 miles an hour, weighing 86,500 pounds. A woman pulls off of Wilbanks Road. It's about 10 o'clock in the morning this past last Monday. Real light traffic. It was after morning rush hour. She comes across the northbound lanes with no problem, crosses the median. And you wouldn't think, being that I'm right on her, I'm right at the intersection, that she would come in front of me. But she did. Right smack dab into my lane, about 30 to 40 feet ahead of me when I'm going 95 feet per second. So about 40 feet ahead of me gives me less than half a second to react. Anybody ever had a wreck? All right. When you have a wreck, this is my first one, not speaking from a lot of experience, but when you have a wreck, a lot of times it's instinct that takes over. It's not you. It's a Jesus take the wheel moment. All right, that was this type of moment. I'm going to pause here and give you a quick other background. There's two things that I always thought would happen if somebody pulled out in front of me point blank. Either I would hit them, which would either hang them up under my undercarriage and I'd drag them down the highway, or they'd get under my truck and I might run over them in pretty good ways, or I'd knock them straight out a long ways. Either way, it'd be detrimental for them. Option two, beeline for the ditch. Turn the wheel really hard, trailer turns over on top of them. That happened around the time Brother George Canada passed away. Some of you might remember that at the funeral home, down the hall from Brother George Canada, was, I think, a couple of occupants of a Ford F-150 that was hit by one of our trucks also. Not a live haul truck, it was hauling frozen chicken. He was going northbound on 365, southbound Ford F-150 turned in front of him. He hit him, then he swerved instinctively, turned his load of chickens over on top of him, made them pancakes, all right, killed him. So those aren't good options. Option C that I never thought of is Christ. And here's what took over. So I'm in the southbound lane, 65 miles an hour. She comes into my lane. I had a half a second to react. I didn't have time to honk. Didn't have time to blink, really. Had time to say, oh, my goodness, with a stream of exclamation points behind it. I got on the edge of my seat, jabbed the brake pedal, and did a, I never even knew about this maneuver. God took over. A sidestep swerve. That's the only thing I know to call it. I sidestepped about a half a lane and straightened back up in order to stay underneath my trailer so it wouldn't turn over on them. I got into this right turning lane. All right. When I did that, that was still enough to make the trailer oscillate like this. It was still trying to turn over. But by God's grace, it didn't. I hit her. And you can't tell in this picture, because this is after the wreck, by the way. You can't see any damage on my truck. But here's the initial point of impact on my truck. If I hadn't have sidestepped, it would have been here. So the initial point of impact with her rearview mirror, then her front quarter panel hit right here on my left steer tire. I chewed her all up right there, and then she rubbed down this side, and then that initial impact knocked her around this way. She entered my lane kind of at an angle like this. I knocked her around backwards, and the back of her car hit my front drive axle on the outside tire. And these steel step mounts for the aluminum fuel tank steps dug into the skin of her car. Really deep. Now, then it shot her off onto towards the grass median here. And I just, at that time, was just trying to stop and not turn over. Well, I finally came to a stop. It took me 500 feet or more after the impact to stop. And I see her wobbling out of the highway. Her car's wobbling over to the, try to get over to the shoulder to get out of traffic. So I said, well, she's all right. She got out, she started walking around. I said, thank the Lord. I got out, started to check out my load. You would think 300 cage doors would be open. That's how many doors we have, is 300. There's 20 chickens behind each door, about 6,000 chickens at a time. You would think all of them would be open. With me stopping that hard, I locked up one of my tandems. Well, I came to a stop, checked all of them. Only one door out of 300 was open. So the trailer was upright, no chickens spilled out. They died several hours later, but they survived the initial wreck, okay? They made it to their destination. So then I thought, well, now I've just hit somebody with a tractor trailer. Maybe I should check on her. She's wandering around, but still she might need medical attention. So I start the long walk back to her. Go to the next slide, please. This is just a little bit closer view. That's after the repairs were made. Knocked off the oil hub seal there, right there, and that was had to be replaced. Very minimal damage. Next slide. Hi, that's her car and the lady there. Now, this is where I came to a stop. I started this long walk. First I was walking. Then I started to jog. Then I started to run. Because as I kept hollering for her, I said, lady, you okay? You okay? And she said, she didn't even acknowledge me. She was trying to get into this door in the back. This is a truck driver's worst nightmare, because after you just hit a car, you don't want to think that there's a baby on board. I had just shut that door with a tractor trailer, so it wasn't coming open. That one wouldn't have done any good. She runs around to the driver's side. By this time, I'd run over here, didn't even bother to talk to her really more. I just wanted to see if that baby was okay. So I opened the back door on the left side, got in there. There was a little 19-month-old beautiful baby boy in perfect shape. Not a scratch, not a bruise. And he wasn't crying. He wasn't even whimpering. He was looking around as if to say, Mama, that was fun. Let's do it again. You know, he had that kind of look on his face. A few minutes later, he was playing peekaboo. He said, peep-boo, peep-boo. He was playing peekaboo with all of us standing around there. So me and this lady, Susan, and her boy, John Patrick, we stood in the grass and got to fellowship for the next couple hours. My first question was, well, I wonder why you pulled out in front of me. Now you say, well, you should have been mad at her. I wanted to hug them too, because they should have been dead. I was this close from looking at their dead bodies in this car, and instead they're standing here in perfect shape. Wasn't a bit mad. All I kept saying was hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I was speaking in tongues almost, because she's alive. Both of them are alive. So we stood in the grass and talked for a while, and my first question, why'd you pull out in front of me? Just curious, making conversation. She said, well, I thought you were in the right turning lane, which is sensible. Most of us have misjudged a lane before, even in broad daylight. I told her lady just a few months ago, I did the same thing. I didn't get hit, but I did that on our family vacation, pulled out in front of somebody in Pigeon Forge because I thought they were in a different lane. She's having an off day, she said. I said, well, what's the problem? I'm going to tell you about this lady. She came from California. This is best I understand her story. She came all the way from California to North Georgia, or actually to South Georgia, at Albany, where her grandson lives. That boy that was with her is her grandson. Her daughter, the boy's mom, is in Lee Arundel Prison, the state prison. She didn't ever mention the dad. I guess he's out of the picture. So she came all across the country like that brother, like Brother Bannum talked about, that mother deer. She's got a real mother instinct. Going all across the country, knowing she'll face dangers, not knowing she'll get hit by a truck, came all the way across the country to South Georgia to reside and raise this boy. Well, that particular day, she came up from South Georgia, all the way up to Lee Arundel Prison, to try to get some signatures from her daughter to get custody of that kid so she can raise him. She didn't even get the signatures. The girl had gotten moved to a different facility. I don't understand exactly what happened. Came all the way up here then to not get signatures and instead get hit by a truck. Furthermore, she was lost because Lee Arundel Prison is down there in Alto. She's up here in Baldwin. Pulls out dazed, confused, lost, distraught. If that's not enough, she just had a hernia surgery. So now she's facing another hernia surgery, she said, coming up. So you're talking about problems. That's the lady we need to pray for. I mentioned her Wednesday night. Y'all be praying for Susan. That's her name. And at the end of it all, when I parted ways with her, I stood here and I told her, I said, Susan, you know, you're going to think this is weird. I just met the lady. I said, Susan, I love you. You've got a real mother instinct. You are a real mother. And I said, you raise up this boy and tell him about Jesus Christ the way that my grandmother did me and my mom. You know, there's about five mothers in my life that are very important to me. And we named two of them, named two of our kids after two of them, Sister June and my great-grandmother Eula, that have had great influence on my life. Brother Branham said that mothers are the fifth gospel, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, mothers. Mothers, I told this lady, said, you mothers can have an influence in little kids' hearts, like Rachel and Monica teaching those little ones in Sunday school. They're perfect. Amen. Sister Gail teaching all those little ones, you know, when she used to. Amen. Because you have a place in their heart that nobody else can influence. Right. You know, a father can influence them in different ways. But you're their, you know, their mother. And she began to break down and cry, and she said, I will. There's one last part of this testimony. That it's just speculation, but our God is a mighty God, and he works in mysterious ways. A few months prior to this, at the beginning of the summer, I hit a dog. I've never hit an animal as big as a dog. I've run over squirrels and possums. I've never run over a dog, but it was in this very same spot. Now, that's odd. Isn't God odd? Because of all the places I drive, all over North Georgia and South Carolina, you wouldn't think I'd hit a dog and a woman in the same place. So what about that? And I thought about it and pondered it for days. I don't know, but I can speculate one thing. I said option C. Christ took over when I did that swerve, that sidestep swerve. All right? Christ took over. I regretted hitting that dog. I hit him. I exploded him. He disintegrated. I hit him so hard. I never swerved. I never tried to miss him. I laid into the air horn for quite some time. He stood his ground. I thought, this is very strange. And then I hit him, and I turned my head. I couldn't stand to watch. But the way that I hit him, it took him forever to decompose. I know I'm grossing you out. But I watched his remains in the road. He had a nicely, neatly stacked fur coat in the right turning lane. And for months, I watched those remains as I came by, and I said, I wish I had swerved. I wish I had been more, reactive, you know, or responsive, instead of just freezing up. I have a tendency to freeze up when I'm going to hit something because I don't want to turn over or have a wreck. So maybe, just maybe, God was working on my instinct, reprogramming me to where that when this accident happened, because I think God knew whenever this accident happened that I would react in that way and save their lives. So it wasn't me that saved their life, it was Christ all the way through.
Amen.
That's all the testimony I have. Thank you.
Sister Monica's Sunday school class, please come up for your special as we sing Be It Unto Me.
Be it unto me according to your word, according to your promises. Thank you.
Baptist camp.
Chris and Brother Paul come up and take the offering. Let's pray over the offering. Lord God, I thank you for this day, Lord, and I thank you for giving us life, Lord, and letting us know your word, Lord, and coming down to us, Lord, in word form, Lord. And Lord, please help whoever gives, Lord, freely from their hand, Lord, to this offering, Lord. As Brother Ward said this morning, Lord, the woman who gave everything, Lord, and the man who wanted to be seen, Lord, but please help us be like the woman, Lord, to just give up all, Lord, to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord. I pray you'll bless this offering. Amen.
Let's sing Come to My Soul, page 39.
Come to my soul, precious Jesus, my Lord.
Sister Christine has a special.
Let's see. change the order of service?
Praise the Lord. Amen. Certainly wonderful to be a Christian. Amen. Amen. The world's chaos and all the things that are happening, and science don't have the answer. Education don't have the answer. Religion doesn't have the answer. Amen. Politics doesn't have the answer, but I'm so glad we have the answer. Amen. Hey, amen. He said in His Word, ye shall know the truth. Amen. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. What a privilege it is to be free people. Yes, amen. We certainly enjoyed our brother's testimony of how the God was gracious to him and to the woman and her son. And I do feel sorry for the chickens. Survive a major accident. If they would have gave him a little grace. Amen. That was comical, brother. I thought that was funny. Amen. May the Lord richly bless you. Certainly wonderful to be here. I enjoyed just like being at home this morning. I just enjoyed the preaching and just being ourselves. And we trust something was said to encourage you and to help you. And truly that's my desire, friends, is that I could just be a witness for my Lord. Amen. And you know, someone told me one time the greatest compliment they ever had, they got it at work and said somebody walked up to them and said, you know, I know we don't believe alike. I know you believe different than I do. As a message brother was telling this, and he said, I know that you don't believe the way we do, but I just want you to know that every time I get around you, he said, I feel the presence of Jesus Christ. And the brother was telling me, he said, you know, that was the greatest compliment, and that is.
Right.
That's the greatest compliment. Not in the, oh, man, what a preacher. I ain't interested in that. But for someone to say, I saw Jesus when you preached this morning. That's what it's all about. Amen. So may the Lord richly bless you. If you have your Bibles this evening, turn with us to the book of 1 Kings. We're going to read there from 1 Kings chapter 17, starting at verse 8. And very, very familiar scripture to us all. And we actually was going to go another direction, but I just kind of sitting in the study and listening and singing, I just kind of wanted to go this direction. So we trust that it'll be a blessing to you. Amen. Amen. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 8. Praise the Lord. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise thee and get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman to sustain thee. Now, that word commanded, it means to appoint, to ordain of a divine act.
Right.
To appoint, ordain of a divine act.
Right.
So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, it must have been a Kentuckian. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, "Bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand." And she said, "As the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die." And Elijah said unto her, "Fear not. Go and do as thou hast said, but make me therefore a little cake first and bring it unto me. And after make it for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the day the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth." And the same God that made her that promise has made us the same promise in this hour that we're living in. Amen. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. Now that's a good thing to do. Just do what Elijah says to do. And she and he and her house did eat many days. Notice there wasn't one meal for Elijah and one meal for the widow woman. They all ate from the same barrel. Hallelujah. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Amen. Let us bow our heads. I want to speak to you this evening for a few minutes on the meal barrel. The meal barrel. Do you love him? Heavenly Father, thy word is true. In the name of Jesus Christ, we gather here this evening, Lord, to give you honor and praise, for thou art worthy. And Lord, we believe you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. And Lord, we believe that whatever we have need of has been provided for us in this hour. You are our healer. You are our guide. You are our comfort. You are our strength. You are our joy. You're our shield. You're our buckler. You're our helmet. Our feet are shod with the preparation of the God. You're our everything, Lord. And we look to you this evening knowing that everything we have need of, Lord, lays in the message of the hour. God, what a privilege it is, Lord, to feast upon this unfailing word body of the Son of Man ministry. Lord, come, bless your children today. Move among your people, Lord. Bless Brother Samuel here, Lord. Brother Wade, the other officers of the church. God, bless their ministries. Use them in a great way, Lord, we pray. May your presence come among us in such a way that when we leave, Lord, may we say, "Did not our hearts burn within us?" Thank you for moving among us this morning and speaking to our hearts, Lord, and those that responded. And Father, may you speak once again, Lord. And when we leave, Lord, there's needs here, Father, but there's not a need here greater than you. So we just look to you. May you come and do great things, we pray. For we humbly ask these things in Jesus' name. And the bride says, amen. Amen. God bless you, saints. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. How many is full of food?
Amen.
Well, we'll try to preach above it. Amen. Amen. God richly bless you.
Amen.
Now, in our scripture reading this afternoon, we find that there's a great famine in the land. For the Bible says that it had not rained nor dew in over 3.5 years. Now, the reason for this famine was because of the mighty prophet Elijah. Under the leadership of God, had walked right up into the presence of the king. And he had pronounced judgment upon his kingdom because of the moral decay that had taken place. And we know that our nation today is in the condition that it's in. It's not because an army from the outside has invaded us, but it's the corruption of our own moral decay. Amen. Our problems has come from within our nation because we have left the fundamentals of the gospel that God gave us to live by. Our nation was not founded upon Islamic. Our nation was not founded upon some other religion, but it was founded upon the Word of God.
Amen.
Amen. Is that right, friends? Now, I say today, if people don't want to abide by the Word of God, let them find them another country to go to. Praise the Lord. Sorry, I just had to say that. But it's the truth, friends. Why should we change the way we believe to accommodate everybody else? Let them come God's way, for it is the only way.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. So we find that judgment was upon this kingdom. The prophet of God said the people was poverty stricken. There was no water. He said it was a reflection. The condition of the nation was the reflection of the moral decay of that nation. But Elijah was not afraid. Oh God, give us a man today that's anointed with that same anointing. He was not afraid to stand before that king, for he had been in the presence of one who was greater than that king. He had been in the presence of Jehovah. Therefore, he knew exactly where he was standing. And I'm so glad today we're not wishy-washy. We don't know where we're standing. We have been in the presence of God. Hallelujah. And God has established for us in this hour where we are to stand. Is that right? He had been in the presence of God. And anytime a man is standing in the presence of God, he knows exactly where he's standing. And Elijah walked right up into the presence of that king. He didn't stutter. He didn't stammer. He didn't apologize. Because he knew what he was talking about. He walked right up into the presence of that king. He could say to that king, "Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, there will be no rain nor dew until I call for it." Huh? Now that's awful bold words for a say of a man that was born of a woman. Huh? Where did he get such boldness? Hallelujah. "It will not rain nor dew until I call for it." Why did he say that? Why? Because it was according, he said, according to my word. It will not happen according to my word. Why? Because he had the word of the Lord. He was a prophet. And the word of the Lord comes to the prophet. Notice he spoke as though it was God himself speaking. Elijah spoke as if it was God himself speaking. Now listen to this quote. I know you don't mind me quoting the prophet. Said Jesus said, "If ye shall say," what is it? When you're out from under Babylon, when you're out from under unbelief, when you're out from under superstition, when you're out from under all these things, and you're filled with God's own life, your voice is his voice. You are, he said, you are, because I spoke it. When we're out from under confusion, when we're out from under Babylon, when we're out from under superstition, oh, you better be careful. When we know where we stand as God's children, as sons of God, do we speak with the authority of the word? For we are the seed of Abraham. Abraham did not speak by emotion. He did not speak by sensation, but he spoke by the faith in the word. Hallelujah. Amen. Said, "It will not dew nor rain until I call for it." Amen. It was as though God himself speaking. Why? He had the mind of God. What did the prophet of God say to the bride? "She'll have, thus saith the Lord," or keep still. She knows what he wants done with the word. Amen. Oh, we live so beneath our privilege. "It'll not rain nor dew will fall from heaven till I call for it." Yes, sir. He was in the presence of God. Amen. Do you love him? Amen. Hallelujah. Notice the continuity of the prophet in his God. God and his prophet, rather. Look at the continuity. He knew exactly what God wanted for that hour. Amen. Oh, it reminds me of another son of God. Remember Adam in the Bible. Amen. Remember Adam. God, who created the animals?
Come on.
It's not a trick question. God created the animals. But who named the animals? God didn't name them. Adam named them. How did Adam know what to name them? Because Adam had the mind of God. Amen. He knew. Amen. He said, "You're a monkey, you're a cheetah, you're a bear, you're an eagle." And God said, "Amen." Not one time did God have to call Adam over. Say, "Adam, son, you're doing a good job. Daddy's proud of you. But you messed up, son." "No, you called that right there a bear. That's not a bear. That's a monkey. Over there is a bear." "No, sir, not one time." Adam said, "You're a monkey, you're a bear, you're a cheetah, you're a lion, you're a tiger." And God said, "That's exactly what I was thinking." There was another son of God stood in this day, said, "I no longer call you church." Hallelujah. "But I call you bride." And God said, "That's exactly what I was thinking." Amen. Hallelujah. Now, it looks like Elijah is not too smart. Because Elijah stood there in that kingdom and pronounced judgment upon the very kingdom he was standing in. It looks like he would have went over here at Commerce and brought judgment upon Lula. Now, in our thinking, that would have been the thing to do. But you see,
He knew. He was not afraid to stand there in that kingdom and pronounce judgment upon that kingdom. Do you know why? Because Elijah done had a place to go.
Right. 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 Exactly.
Amen. Oh my. He done called judgment upon that nation. There'll be no rain. There'll be no dew. Pronounced the judgment upon the very nation he was standing in. But he was not worried because God had done gave him a place to go. They rejected God. They rejected his prophet. They rejected his word. And God was going to dry them up. And God is drying this nation up now. He's drying up for the burning, friends. You can't even look at a car anymore. You can't pull up at the red light and look at the car beside you because you don't know whether they're going to shoot you or not. You know why everybody's so grouchy? You know why everybody's so grumpy? They're drying up. Is that not true, friends? What did Brother Branham say that a sticker was? It was a rolled up leaf because of the lack of moisture. Amen. God's drying this nation up for the burning. You know, they say California's sinking so many inches a day or so many inches a year or a month or something like that. You know why? Because it's pulling so much water out of the ground because they're drying up. Hey, amen. Everybody knows wood burns better when it's dry.
Amen.
Come on, friends. Hey,
amen.
It's a sign we're ready for a burning. That's getting awful dry around here. But don't worry. God's done got a place for us to go. Hallelujah. A prepared place for a prepared people. That ought to make you happy. Why some of y'all frowning for? We done got a place to go. I guarantee you, if you've been on the boat on the Titanic that night, you wished you had a place to go. Amen. Let me tell you, it's time to change ships. I said, we don't need God. We don't need nobody. God himself couldn't sink this ship. And the prophet said, God, by his mighty hand, put the Titanic at the bottom of the ocean. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, the ship of America's sinking. It's time to change boats, friends. Amen. Prepared place for a prepared people. I'm not worried. I'm not sweating. You know, the prophet of God said, if they push that button before one bomb will strike this nation, the bride will be gone. The prophet of God said, they'll never shut her up. God will take her up. Hallelujah. They may silence the workmen, but the work will go on. You're crazy. Well, I'm happy. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Elijah said, Lord, what do you want me to do? God said, get up yonder by the brook of Cherubim and sit down. Huh? All right. It's a very bad place. That's where God wants me to go. That's where I'll go. But let me tell you, if God tells you to go somewhere, that's the best place you can be. They used to argue. They used to debate about it. If God tells you to do something, do it. If God tells you to repent, repent. Don't try to make excuses. Well, my family's that way. It ain't going to work. Just do what God says.
Right.
Huh? Because what do you want me to do, Lord? I pronounce judgment on what you... God said, go up by the brook of Cherubim and sit down.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If a path leads there, follow it.
Yeah, right.
If God's leading, follow it. Amen.
Right.
Amen. So he goes up there and he sits down. I said, now, Lord, what do you want me to do? And God says, sit there.
Yeah.
Pretty simple, ain't it?
Yeah.
But you see, it's always God in simplicity.
Right.
We try to dissect it and figure it out. When we do, we're a million miles off.
Right.
Let's just believe it the way he said it. God knows how to bring it. How does God interpret his word? By bringing it to pass.
Right.
Is that right?
Amen.
Amen. Just go up there and sit down. Just go up there and stay there. You know, so Elijah goes up there. And he sits down. And the first thing you know, he gets a little hungry. Whole belly starts growling a little bit. And he looks around. There ain't no Subway. There ain't no McDonald's. Are you still with me? Huh? Lord, I'm a little hungry. Well, I need some food. I'm up here because you put me up here. Let me tell you something. God's will never take us where his grace cannot keep us.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Amen. If that's where God put him, that's the best place to be. God, I'm getting a little hungry. Don't worry. About that time here. Ah! Ah! Here come a raven.
Come on, a raven.
A bird came by. Do you believe that? Are you serious? You scientific, educated, smart Americans believe that a bird, he ain't got no hands. How'd he cook it? Someone might say, where'd that old holy roller go anyhow? Where's that old holy roller? He went up there on the hill and sat down. God told him to. And did you see that? See that reflection right there? See it right that? Well, that's his head. That's his bow head right there. What's he doing up there? Has he lost his mind?
Yeah.
Talking about three pools and seven thunders, and has he lost his mind? Yes, we've lost our mind. We've got the mind of Christ. Amen. 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 You see him right up there? There he is. Oh, would you look at him up there? He's crazy. He's lost his mind. He's a fanatic. I don't know why they're surprised. That's what they say about us. he'll come back. He'll come back when he gets hungry. He'll come crawling back.
Yeah.
Oh, and you crazy guy sitting up there in the sun. So, well, he'll die up there. He's a fanatic. He'll come down when he gets thirsty. He'll be back when it starts drying up a little bit. You see, it looked like it's the worst place to go because, you know, water runs downhill. So where's water going to dry up first? And to me, it would be on top of the mountain. So if you think if God's going to sustain a man, he'd put him down in the valley. But God didn't put him in a valley. God put him on the mountain to show that it wasn't the brook that was sustaining. It was God that was sustaining him. Oh, don't you see, friends? God puts us in situations sometimes we don't understand. But he does it to show his love to us. He does it to show how big he is, how great he is, how much he loves us. Amen. Oh, he'll be back. He'll be back. He gets a little thirsty. He'll come crawling back. He'll want some of this old Baptist water. He'll want some of this old Catholic water. He'll be back when everything gets dry. But you see, it wasn't Elijah that was getting thirsty. It wasn't Elijah without water. It was them. It was the mockers. It was the scorners. Oh, friends, let them laugh at us. Let them make fun of us. Let them call us what they want to call us. Let them say what they want to say. I'm not the one without water. Amen. I'm not the one without water. They are. They are. Elijah was up there on top of that hill, brother. He's sitting up there. He wasn't worried a bit. He had water. Six o'clock in the morning, he had water. 9:30, he had water. 11 o'clock, 2 p.m. All you gotta do is push play. He had water. He could backstroke in it. He could swim in it.
Come on.
He had water. Everybody else was drying up.
Right.
Nobody else had water.
Right.
But Elijah.
Amen.
Oh, I wish y'all had some water. It's so good. Huh? When you're sweating, when you're hot, and it's dry.
Yeah.
Just a good drink.
Amen.
Oh, so good.
Yeah.
I just wasn't worried. He had water in the morning. He had water at noontime. He had water at supper time.
Right. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Every time Elijah wanted to drink, he just laid over. And, huh? And you get a little bit hungry.
Yeah.
Here come a raven by. With a sandwich in his mouth. Here you are, Elijah.
Yep.
They asked Brother Brandon, do you really believe that a crow fed Elijah?
Oh my.
He said, do you really believe that, Brother Branham? He said, I do. I believe it with all my heart. Why? Because God said so.
Right.
Said, how did the ravens get bread? How did the ravens get meat, Brother Branham? How did those birds fry that meat? Brother Branham gave a scientific answer. You know what he said? I don't know. I don't know. Maybe Elijah didn't know either. But the only thing he knew that when he was hungry, the ravens brought him food. Oh, let me say this afternoon, I don't know how the Holy Ghost works. I don't know how he does what he does. I don't know how he makes blinded eyes open. I don't know how a man can hit a car at 65 miles an hour and nobody gets hurt. I don't know how God does that. I just know God does that. Amen. I don't know how God made Jessica see. I don't know how God got her. Amen. I don't know how God got her out of a wheelchair. I don't know how he did it. I just know that he did it. Amen. They told me, they said, Mr. Ward, if you go into a strange town and your daughter gets sick and they take an x-ray of her head, do not let them operate on her. When they see the condition of her brain, they will want to do surgery. Do not let them. You know what I said? I don't care what the x-ray shows. I don't care what the MRI shows. I don't care what the CT scan shows. I just look at what I've got. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, the doctor said, well, he's wrong a lot of times. People hang their souls on what the doctor said. Do you know, I worked with doctors. Doctors bury their mistakes. Amen. I got nothing against doctors now. I believe in doctors. But when the doctors say they can't do no more to help you, I know another doctor you ought to check out. Oh, God. Hallelujah. You know what? He never even sent me a bill. People hang so much on their doctor. Do you know out of every class of 100 doctors, somebody finished last? You ever thought about that? You ever thought it might be your doctor? Think about it, friends. There's a man up our way up Greenville, Tennessee. He went to the doctor. They did PSA level on him for prostate, you know. They called him and said, you need to come in. Somebody's a beeping or something. It's all right. Said, you need to come in. Said, you've got cancer. We need to get right on it. He said, well, can you give me a few days? He said, you ain't got but a few days. You need to come in. He said, well, I got to take care of my cows and stuff. He said, I'll be right in. So he goes, writes a note, goes out in the field, takes a gun, takes his own life. He left the note and said, I'd rather take my own life than die of cancer.
Yeah.
A few weeks after the funeral, the doctor's office called, said they made a terrible mistake.
Yeah. Yeah.
The report would belong to another person, had got put on the wrong chart.
Yeah. Right.
Said, Brother, what are you saying? I'm saying that to say this. I believe in doctors, friends. You sick, go to a doctor. But when the doctor says he can't help you, I know someone who can.
Right.
Is that all right, friends?
Amen.
Surely believe in divine healing, right?
Amen.
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 I don't know how God does these things. I just know he does them. I don't have to figure it out.
Right.
Huh? I don't have to prove there's a bridge.
Right.
Come on, friends. I don't have to do that.
Right.
I don't believe it because I saw the bridge. I don't believe it because I saw a picture of a cloud. I believe it because God revealed it to me.
Amen.
I don't need some scientific explanation. I don't need that. God revealed it to me by his grace. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Down in the valley, they were drying up. But up on the hill, Elijah had 3 meals a day.
Right.
Amen. Provided by the hand of God.
Right.
Amen. You know, when I was in the Army, I joined the Army when I was 16 years old. My mom and dad had a sign for me. I'd done it so I could get the GI Bill so I could go to college. So I joined when I was 16 years old, and I went into active duty at 17. I was in a program called DEP, Delay Entry Program. I was delayed 11 months before I went on active duty. My whole senior year in high school, I was already in the Army, already signed up. And so I went into the Army in basic training. I was the youngest guy. They called me Babyface. You know, the first time I shaved, I was in the Army. true. So I was, you know, I seen too many John Wayne movies growing up. So I thought I had to be in one of those rough units. Yeah. So I joined the 18th Airborne Corps Field Artillery. Direct fire support for the 82nd. We could be anywhere in the world in 24 hours and ready to fight. But in order to do that, we spent our whole life in the woods. Yeah. Training. Always training. You know where I was at when President Reagan was shot? I was in the woods. You know where I was at when he got out of the hospital? In the woods. We spent our whole life. And so we in the woods, you know, we would train for combat situations. So because we was training for combat situations, they wanted to bring us steaks and they wanted to bring us baked potatoes, but they brought us sea rations. Yeah. How many of you have ever been in the Army? Knows what I'm talking about. You had to remember the sea rations. Some people call them MREs, MRIs, different ones, but sea rations. Now, these sea rations was a pre-packaged meal. You know, I remember some of them was ham and eggs. I used to pray I wouldn't get that one. Beef and potatoes. It was pretty good if you could heat it up. The best was tuna. Oh, man, when I got tuna, I was in heaven. And so we had a little instrument called a P-38. How many remembers that? A little P-38. You know why they called it a P-38? Because you would turn it 38 times, and it would open the can. I've still got mine. Still got mine from my days of the Army. A P-38. And so they would give us these prepackaged meals. Now, I was in the Army from 1977 until 81. 4 years. And they would bring us these sea rations, and we'd open up this box, and we would pull them out. Now, on each one of them was, it would say ham and eggs or beef stew or I'm trying to, tuna was one of them, and different ones that they gave us. And it had some peanut butter, and it had a little pieces of chewing gum, and had some cocoa powder, had some coffee, salt and pepper. All that was in a prepackaged meal. But when you pulled out the can and looked at it, it had a date on it. It told you when that can was processed. Now, I was in the Army from 77 to 81, but I would get cans of sea rations, 1951. 1949. Oh, my God, that's before I was born. 1967, 1963. But you know, you take that P-38, it would be sealed. But you take that P-38 and open up that can, it would go. And when you open it up, if you put a little fire to it, it actually wasn't too bad. Especially if you're hungry. Yeah. Amen. So when I got out of the Army, now, you know, I joined the Army. I wanted to see the world. I was an old boy from Tennessee, never got to see anything. I forget how old I was the first time I ever saw the ocean. We was just poor. We never was able to go anywhere. So I joined the Army. I wanted to see the world. So I joined the Army. Guess where I went? North Carolina. All 4 years. North Carolina. It was unreal. I had the same locker and bed for 4 years. So I got out of the Army in 81. And then, as I told you this morning, the Lord came to me in that old building down there in Jonesboro. I gave my heart to the Lord. I found out, Brother Wade, I was in another army.
Right. Amen. Glory.
And when I got into God's army, guess what? He's let me see the world. I've been in 29 some countries, preached the gospel by the grace of God. Isn't that wonderful? You know, the Bible said He'll give you the desire of your heart. He just knows how to do those things just to show you how much He loves you. Amen. Amen. So I found out I was in another army, God's chosen army. And when I found out I was in God's army, guess what I found out? God also has some pre-prepared meals. And they had a date on them. But when you opened up and put it in there and pushed play, it was just as fresh. I looked at some of the dates. 1947, faith is a substance. 1954, God's only provided way of dealing with sin. 1962, in time evangelism. 1959, looking to the unseen, Los Angeles, California. 1963, the opening of the seals. 1965, the rapture. It was just as fresh as it was the day it was preached. Now, when my daughter was hurt, she was in a coma, on life support for 11 days. She was in a coma for weeks and weeks. She was struck by a train.
Brother Bert Thompson, brother I go to church with, his wife was my first convert. We went to college together. When I came back off of Christmas break and was saved, I got the witness, and she was my first convert. Amen. So she, Brother Bert came down, met, they married, and now they got a house full of kids and live happily ever after. Anyway, Brother Bert came down to the hospital to see me. He said, Brother Darrell, I was on the way down here tonight, and I was listening to the adoption series. It says it sounds like exactly Brother Branham was praying. It sounds exactly like Brother Branham was praying for your daughter. Because now in the accident, you see, I know some of you know, brother, some of you saw the video, and I appreciate you taking the time off your busy schedule to watch Jessica's story. But two of my family was killed, and my little baby girl was dying. She was only 3 years old. She turned 3 in the hospital. So he comes down. He said, you want to hear it? I said, sure. So he goes out the car. He brings the tape in. Now, I had read that soft music would help the brain to heal. So he played soft classical music, soft gospel music, you know. And, of course, we played tapes of Brother Branham there in the ICU, in the room there where she was at. And we just kept those things playing. And so we go in there, and so we take out a tape, and we put this tape in. And he had left it right there where Brother Branham begins to pray. And if you don't mind, if I'd just like to share this with you. This is what he said in Manifested Sons of God. Now remember, two of my family was killed, and my little girl was dying. And Brother Bert said, it sounds exactly like he was praying for your daughter. And now it's called upon us to go immediately to God. And each of us fathers thinks, what if that was our little girl? And how our hearts would burn and hurt within us. And we would call to the churches to immediately have prayer. And some father's heart is burning and aching, Lord. May that great person of the Holy Ghost come just now to that father's heart. Take away every shadow of doubt, every ache, and let him know that thou art God. And there is no disease can stand in thy presence when thy divine commission has been carried out by thy church and thy people. And through the week, we pray, and since last Sunday, I have thought on these ways or these means of prayer. We do not have very much of a weapon as far as it looks to the world. But this little slingshot is deadly when it's held in the fingers of faith. Right. Oh, Lord, may our prayer strike home. That death yonder that hangs over that child, may it be shattered, the darkness and the gloom away from beside the bedside of that infant or that baby or child, little girl. May the great light of God's presence shine upon it. May it come home from that hospital a well child. God, we know just across the river our loved ones wait, and it's glorious. But we love our little ones. And we pray, Lord, that for your glory, you'll spare the life of that child. We as your church rebuke that death and say, stand still yonder. You can't take that child because we claim its life for the kingdom of God's sake. Grant these things, Lord, to go straight to the mark as we direct them in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. And after a while, Brother Bert left. And the nurse came into the room. And she said, Mr. Ward? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, was that you praying for your daughter? I said, no, ma'am. She said, was that someone in your church praying for your daughter? I said, no, ma'am. I said, that prayer was prayed over 35 years ago. But you see, it was just as fresh. Elijah's drinking the water, eating food that a crow brought him. But one day, the river, the creek began to dry up. The brook began to dry up. And God showed Elijah a vision and said, go down to the city, for I have commanded, not the ravens this time, but I have commanded a widow woman to sustain you. Huh? He took him to the poorest of the poor. I've commanded a widow woman to sustain you. And she didn't even have enough meal in the barrel for her or her son. And God said, I've done commanded her to feed you. Amen. Hallelujah. Do you love him? Amen. I've commanded it. I have ordained it. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. When God ordains anything, it's got to happen. It's there. God will meet it. I've commanded a widow woman there to take care of you, to sustain you. Now think, brother. Can I have just a few minutes? Think, is it not a strange thing that God would send his prophet to a widow woman's house? What a place to send a man of God. But you see, she must have been a real virtuous woman, or he would have never sent his prophet down there.
Amen. She must have been a real virtuous woman, or God would have never sent the prophet to her. Now notice, neither one of these people knew each other. He just knew her by vision. They never knew each other. Like the black woman in Memphis, when the prophet of God went to her house, being led by the Spirit, and she's standing out there by the gate. And she said, "Morning, Parson." He said, "How'd you know I was a preacher?" She said, "Not only that, I knew you was coming." He said, "Where's your briefcase?" "You're supposed to have a briefcase. You're supposed to have a satchel." He said, "I left it in the room." He said, "I'm William Branham. I pray for the sick. Ever heard of me?" "No, sir. I ain't never heard of you." She didn't know Brother Branham from Adam, but she knew God. She got a hold of God. God got a hold of his prophet. Hallelujah. And sent him down to the woman's house. She didn't know him. He didn't know her. But he was looking for her. That's my ministry, is catch that bride. She must have been an honorable woman. She must have been the type of woman that Elijah was a man. For how can two walk together except they agree? Now, God chose this woman out of all women. So she was a chosen lady. He chose her out of all the women that was there, all the women that was in Israel, to entertain his prophet. And he would have never chosen an immoral woman to entertain his prophet. The prophet said this widow woman was a Gentile. She had not took the mark of the unbeliever, but had kept herself in the time of famine. The prophet said she represents the church of today. The prophet also said this woman was ordained to life. Brother Dow, who is this woman? My dear brother, my sister, it's you. She was typing you. For what did God say before the dreadful day of the Lord? Behold, I send who? Who? You. Elijah. God would have never sent a prophet to an immoral woman. Or make the Pope shout. Amen. What's wrong with those message people? Amen. Think of it, friend. That ought to make us the happiest people on earth. I wasn't looking for God. You say, "I sought God." I said, "No, you didn't. You never sought God. It was always God looking for you." Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, "Behold, I send you Elijah the prophet." Now, the widow woman, she goes to the wheelbarrow. I'm trying to hurry. She goes to the wheelbarrow. There's not much left. She goes over the cruse of oil, just enough for one spoonful. Just a good tablespoon is about all she had. That's all stood between her and death. Now, I suppose that night, there was an all-night prayer meeting. And, brother, when things get to going wrong, that's the time to pray. When everything's going good, none of us pray like we should pray. But let trouble strike you home one time. You'll know how to pray. Come on, somebody. Persecution is good for us. Tribulation is good for us. We've asked God for peace and comfort. But God gives us the best thing he can give us. That's trials and tribulations. They are better. They're more precious to us than gold. Because through our trials and through our tests, there's a character molded in us that's fit to reign. Amen. You see, my brother, my sister, if we prayed about our problems instead of worrying about our problems, how much better off we would be. Now, isn't it strange that God will let us get right down to the end of the road? And no doubt she checked up and checked her life. Said, "Lord God, I've served you. I've done all I know to do. I've met your requirement." But let me say this afternoon, friends, you may be going through a great trial. You may be going through a great test. You may be facing a great battle with sickness or whatever it is. But let me tell you this morning, if you have met God's requirements, then stand your ground. What did Moses tell him? Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Hey, amen. When you've done all you've done to know to do, ain't time to quit. Well, everything's going wrong. Everybody's leaving the mess. I don't care if everybody leaves. I ain't going nowhere. Amen. Amen. Just stand still. It's not a time. What did he say when these things come to pass? Why does it surprise us? The prophet told us these things would happen. The prophet said there would be a falling away. Huh? Is that true, friends? Remember when Jesus went to Jairus' house and the little girl was dead? What did they do when he got there? Who was he? He was the manifested promise for the hour. He was the word for that hour made flesh. Is that right? Amen. Jesus is God. Is that right? He was God made flesh. Is that right? Amen.
I know you believe that. And she stood there. And what did they do? He said, she's not dead. She sleeps. You know what they did? They found a problem with his message. They found a problem with his message. And they laughed him to scorn, the Bible said. They made fun of him. But you know what he did? He put them out. And as soon as they went out, there come a resurrection. Hello? Get ready. Friends, have you ever seen an hour that everybody's talking about body change? A man becomes a woman and call him a hero? Amen.
That's right.
You mean he knows more about himself than God does? Nonsense. I said nonsense. Well, that's not political correct. Well, I'm not in politics, so it don't matter to me. Come on, friends. And you know that's the truth. But look at the hour. Everybody's trying to change their body. Now, if they're doing that out there, what do you reckon fixing to happen in here? Amen. I'm looking for a body change too, but it's not by a plastic surgeon. Amen. It's by God Almighty himself. If anybody asked you where I'm going someday soon. Oh, hallelujah. I'm going up yonder. Anybody going with me? Amen. It's going home time. Don't get discouraged. Lift up your eyes. Amen. Amen. I've met God's requirements. The old fella could wake up, you know, I could just hear him say, Mama, I'm so hungry. Mama, look, see if there's something to eat. She knew there wasn't nothing to eat, but she'd go to the cabinet and she'd fill around and she'd come back and say, Junior, honey, drink this water. Just drink this water. It'll be better in the morning. Just hang on to the morning. Just hang on. Oh, let me tell you, the Bible says, weeping may endure for the night. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Just hang on. The day is far spent, but hang on. It's the rising of the sun. It's the dawning of a new day. Couldn't sleep good. He was hungry. But she knew she met God's requirement. She knew she met all God's requirement, and yet God was still silent. Now watch. It seemed like God didn't even care for her. Huh? It seemed like God didn't care whether she would live or die. Now, how many times have we felt like that? When we have a problem or we're facing difficulty and we call on God and call on God and call on God. And it seems like God's silent. It seems like God don't even, your prayer goes right off your lips and falls on the floor. Huh? And no doubt she'd sought God and sought God. And it seemed like God didn't even care whether she lived or died. And one of Satan's greatest tools, I hope you're listening to me, one of Satan's greatest tools against us is to try to get us to believe that God don't love us. We believe God loves Brother Dale and God loves Brother Wade and God loves Brother Wade's wife, but God don't love me. And Satan says, that's right, that's why you're facing this battle. That's why you're facing this sickness. That's why your children's giving you such a hard time, because God don't love you. One of Satan's greatest tools. What did Brother Branham say? Remember, said Satan tried, he couldn't come and tell me there wasn't a God because I met him.
Right.
But what he tried to come and tell me was, yeah, there's a God, but God don't love you.
Right. Yeah.
Now, why did he do that? Because he knows it's effective.
Right.
It works on prophets, it works on pastors, it works on evangelists, it works on mama, daddy, brother, sister. It works on, if he can get us to believe that our problems are greater than our God, then the next thing you know, we'll be mumbling and we'll be complaining and we'll quit coming to church and we'll sit further in the back and we won't say amen. Amen or ouch, what? Amen. I really do feel at home here, praise God. But it seemed like God didn't care whether she lived or died. But all, don't miss this, all the time God was working it out. It wasn't that God didn't know. God knew exactly what was taking place. Sometimes the old saying is, we can't see the forest for the trees. All she could see was the trees. God was looking at the whole forest. Amen. Let that be a lesson to us, that many times we're having problems in our life, issues in our life, we think God is silent. Lord, I've prayed, I've heard nothing. Are you listening? Are you there? But in reality, God is working it out for our good. Write this down. Put it on your refrigerator. Remember this. Every miracle starts with a problem. Well, brother, I want a miracle in my life. Well, you got to have a problem first. Every miracle starts with a problem. I say it humbly, but I say it by the grace of God. Jessica's testimony has run around the world. The last I heard, over 40, 50,000 people has watched her video. I get calls all the time from different places where people was watching and God healed them. Just from watching the testimony. But you see, that only comes after the great trial.
Right, right.
Did I have anything to do with it? I had nothing to do with it. I just happened to be standing there when it happened. It was all God. God was working the whole thing out. God was, I was on an airplane the other day and a man sitting beside me and we got to talking, you know, and I always promised God, if you'll raise my daughter up, I'll try to tell the world what you did for her. So I tried to keep my promise. And so I moved the conversation over and I began to tell him about Jessica. And he goes, I just saw that video. Who could do that but God? But you see, God don't always ask us to understand everything. God don't always. I remember the night of the accident. My wife, she was so upset. Her father was killed. Her sister was 8-year-old. She was killed. Our girl, that she was dying. They was fighting. She was fighting for her life. The news report, come on. Little 2-year-old Jessica Ward fighting for her life tonight. And we was there in a little room that they gave us. And my wife, she said, I'm going to be sick. And I went and got a wastebasket. And I can see her in my mind. Her hands were just shaking. Her whole body was shaking. And she was crying. And she was trying to throw up. She said, I don't understand it. I don't understand. Why would God do us this way? She said, you're gone all the time. You're never home. You're always out preaching somewhere. Why would God do us this way? And I remember my Samuel, I just grabbed her hands. I said, Cheryl, listen to me. Listen to me. I said, I don't know. I don't know why it's happened. But you see, sometimes God don't ask us to understand. He just asks us to trust Him. Amen. Like the person said, well, I trusted God till the reins broke. Oh, God. That's the time to trust Him is when the reins break. Amen. Amen. It looked like God was silent. It looked like God didn't care. But God done told Elijah. God had done dried up the brook. Amen. He told Elijah, I have commanded a widow woman to feed you. He had already commanded her. But guess what? She didn't even know it. She was unconscious. Oh, God, don't miss this. She was unconscious of the fact that everything she was fixing to do was ordained of God by a divine act. She prayed all night long. She believed somehow God would do something. She gets up in the morning. She knows what she's going to do. Said, so we'll get me a little cake. I want to fix it. I'm going to get me some sticks. I'm going to make a fire. I'm going to make a little cake. And I'm going to set Junior on my lap. And I'm going to say, Junior, I want you to eat this cake. He said, Mama, ain't you hungry? I'm going to tell Junior I'm not hungry. Yeah. And I'm going to give him the whole cake.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to sit and wait for death. That was it. She was down to her last cake.
Amen.
I'm going to make a cake. I'm going to give it to her son. I'm going to tell him, I'm not hungry, honey. You eat it and wait for death.
Yeah.
But remember, friends. It's always in the darkest hour.
Right.
It's when God moves the greatest.
Right. Amen.
Oh, Brother Darrell, I don't understand my trials. I don't understand this dark hour. It's my darkest hour, Brother Darrell. I'm going through such a horrible trial. I'm going through such a dark time. You know what I say? Thank God. Because it's those times that God always moves the greatest.
Right.
Brother Darrell, I'm at my wit's end. What am I going to do? Start expecting the miracle. Start expecting God. Come on, friends. Start expecting God to do something. That's God's pattern of the word.
Huh?
When did God show up on the sea? When the clouds got dark and the first drop of rain fell? No. When the boat was about sunk and the wind was blowing and the boat was tossed everywhere. It was their darkest hour that Jesus come walking on the water. When the woman with the blood issue, when did Jesus show up?
Right.
Not the first day she went to the doctor with the blood issue, but after the doctor had took all of her money, took all of her insurance, then he said, I can't help you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, why didn't you tell her that at the first? But after she'd spent all of her money on the doctors, then they said, I can't help you. But when the doctor says, I can't help you, Jesus says, I can. When did he show up? It was at her darkest hour, when all hope was gone. When did he show up at Jairus' house? Not when she got sick, but when death had took the child. Is that right, friends? Little did she know, up on the hillside, Elijah was by the brook. God had done dried up the brook. He was sending him to feed her, to sustain her. Amen. He saw a vision, no doubt. He saw a little fence, a little tree or something like that. He said, go down to the widow woman's house. I have commanded her by a divine act. I have ordained her to sustain you. How do you know, friends? I don't know hardly any of you. You don't know me. Probably some of the first time you ever saw me. But God put us here this evening. How do you not know that it could not be by divine act that God ordained this very meeting this weekend for your problem, for your trouble? This is your hour. This is your time. This is your healing. This is your miracle. This is your deliverance. Do not miss your time. Well, I'll go see. No, don't come like that. Come expecting that you're the one God's going to do something for. Maybe all the preparation for this meeting. Brother Samuel, first time I ever come this way. Brother Samuel called and invited me to come. You know where I'm supposed to be this weekend? Way up in the British Columbia. That's where I'm supposed to be this weekend, but I'm here. Amen. Amen. Maybe God ordained this whole day just for you. Amen. Well, that's the way I'd believe it. Well, I don't know, Brother Darrell. How's that going to help you? Well, I don't know if God can help me or not. Well, you get what you expect. Come on, friends. Is that not true? We drag ourselves in like we're half dead. We ought to come through that door like we are. We are winners. The Bible said we win. We are winners. We ought to act like winners, walk like winners, talk like winners, say amen like winners, because we are winners. The devil walks like he's a winner and he loses. We win and walk like we lose. There's something wrong with that. Huh? So she's out there in the yard. And here's Elijah. Now, Elijah's walking down the road. Oh, I've got to hurry. He's walking down the road. And no doubt he's singing, I'm one of them. I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. And he's walking down the road. And here's this widow woman. She goes out by the gate looking for sticks because they got to be right. It just can't be any kind of stick. It's got to be the right stick. So she's looking for sticks. And she's singing, I'm one of them. I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. And Elijah's coming down the road. He's singing, I'm one of them. Oh, let me tell you something, friends. When two one of thems meet, when two one of thems meet, it's the 4th of July. It's fireworks. Kaboom. Hallelujah. What happens when two omnipotents meet? When God and man comes together, something's got to shake. Something's got to take place. Amen. Hallelujah. Someone give me two sticks. I want to make a fire. So she's out there with her back and she's looking for the sticks. And he walks right up to the gate. He says something like this. Good evening, friends. And there's just something about that voice.
Right.
How many knows what I'm talking about?
Glory.
I was 5 years old the first time I ever heard it. Didn't understand it, but there was something about that voice. My mom and daddy backslid on the Lord and took me out of church. You parents don't do that. I don't understand. They'll keep their kids in church when they're little. And about the time they get 7 or 8 years old, they backslide on God and go out and the kids just go crazy. Don't do your kids that way. And then they try to come back in. Try to bring the kids back in line after they went out there and tasted all that.
Yeah. Right,
that's what my parents did to me. I wasn't in church from the time I was like 9 until I was 21. And I was in the Army and I was stationed at Fort Bragg. It's just about 6 hours away. And I used to come home on the weekends. And I'm ashamed to tell you, but I was used to drive out of town listening to a group called White Snake, something, Black Snake, Red, some kind of snake. There's a song called Train Train, and I used to put that song on, crank it up, and drive through Johnson City like a maniac, heading back to the Army. And I used to go right by Happy Valley, see him up there on the steps.
Yeah.
Little did I know, and just a few years later, the Lord would let me preach to him. And I went right by, and I remember one time I went over into North Carolina, Boone, North Carolina, listening to rock and roll music. And all of a sudden, the radio faded out. And Brother Branham faded in.
Yeah.
Started preaching. And I listened to it all the way through up to Winston-Salem. And it faded back out. Because there's something about that voice. It calls to you. You ought to be the happiest person on earth. Amen. So he says to her, bring me a drink. Now watch. He's asking for water. Now she's got more water than she's got food. So she turns to get the water. Why? Because she's a character. You know, she's a character like Elijah. She's a server. She's a giver.
Right. Yeah.
Amen. And so he's a nice man, a nice voice there. So I'll give you some water. After all, you know, what am I going to need water for? I ain't got no more food. This is it. So she goes and turns to get the water. And then he says, and bring me a little cake.
Right.
Now, he's not asking for her water. He's asking her for everything she has. This day, I will give my all. He's asking her to give. Now watch. If it had just been the kind of character of a woman she was, if it had just been her, no doubt she would say, well, I'll split the cake with you or I'll give it to you. But you see, she was going to give that to her son. And we all know how much we'll take care of our children. We'll suffer everything for our children. Is that right, Fred? So he wasn't asking her to give something she's going to eat herself. He was asking her to give him something she was going to give her son.
Right.
But you see, God never asks you for something, but what he's got something better for you.
Right.
Ain't it something?
Glory.
God just asks us to come to church 3 times a week.
Yeah.
Pay our tithes. Live right.
Yeah.
Y'all do have church 3 times. However many times you have church, I don't know. You know what I'm saying. He says, and bring me a cake. Now he's asking her brother for everything she has.
Right. Yep.
And when he sees that she is going to get it,
right.
When he sees she's willing to give him that cake, she heard the words that every believer longs to hear.
Right.
Thus saith the Lord.
Right.
Bring me one now.
Right.
And go make one for your son.
Yeah.
And go make one for you. And go make another one for your son, make another one for you, and bring me another one.
Yeah.
And then go make two for your son, make two for you, and go ahead and make me three.
Right, exactly.
And then go back and make 6 more for you, and make 6 more for your son, and I believe I'll have 8 more after that.
Right.
Hallelujah!
Right.
Are you crazy, Elijah? No, sir! Thus saith the Lord, the meal barrel will not go empty, or the oil will not dry up. Hallelujah. Every time that widow woman that was ordained to life, every time she went to that barrel of meal, there was meal in the barrel. And there was oil in the cruse. But you see, she had to empty out first. The more she emptied out, the more that came back. Well, we come to church too full. Especially in the 2 o'clock service. We come too full. But how we need to empty out when we come in. And the more I can empty out, the more God can fill me up. Amen. You see, God must have first place. He must have first place in your heart, first place in your life, first place in everything you do or what you are. God must be first. He doesn't want second place. God does not deserve second place. He deserves our best.
Amen.
Our best amen. Our best hallelujah.
Amen.
Our best song. Come on, somebody. He deserves our best.
Amen. Exactly right.
Everything that we've got, he deserves it. But you see, God will take second place. He'll take third place. He'll take fourth place. He'll take last place. He'll take whatever place you'll give him. But he deserves first place. As soon as she emptied out and gave it to Elijah, it was just as though she gave it to God. What you've done unto the least of these, my little ones, you have done it unto me. I can't have just a few more minutes. She stayed under the word of Elijah. As long as she stayed under the word of Elijah, there was food in due season.
Amen.
Notice there wasn't meal in every barrel. There's all kinds of barrels in the city. There was all kinds of barrels in the city, but there's only one barrel. That place was drying up. There was a famine in the land. People were hungry. People were thirsty, but not at her house. She had spiritual food in due season. There was all kinds of barrels, but only hers had the blessing of Elijah on it. I don't know about you, but if I lived in Georgia, I would find me a place to go that has the blessing of Elijah upon it. God had provided a meal barrel to sustain life. He's done the same for us today. Whatever you have need of, just reach in the barrel. If we can grab the reality of the fact that He's the same, and let God operate on our faith. Take everything away and we wake up to the fact to know that He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. We'll have perfect faith to work on throughout the coming week. Why? Perfect faith masters every circumstance. You don't need to go running here and there. Well, I saw this on Facebook. Forget about it. Well, I saw this on YouTube. That's the problem. It's YouTube. Huh? Stay away from that. Huh? Stay away from those meals. There's no life there. Need to spend our time looking for another meal barrel. We just need to stay with the one God's provided for us. In the evening time, Elijah restores all things. It was in the evening time that this meal barrel, the end of everything she knew, everything was running out. It was at that end time that Elijah came with a restoration message and restored the meal barrel to her that would sustain her in the time of famine. Do you love Him? Like down in Egypt, they were feeding on the lamb. God provided for them. Just before their exodus, God provided for them a lamb. And He said, don't add anything to it. Don't put Dale's seasoning to it. You know, don't put Daryl's seasoning to it. Just take it the way God gave it to us. There's a real seasoning called Dale's seasoning. I wasn't just saying. Amen. Don't add anything to it. Don't take anything. Just eat it the way I gave it to you. Roast it with fire and water. Is that right? So they prepared this lamb just before the exodus, just before the going out. And I can see old grandpa coming in there, barely moving. Grandpa, it's supper time. Huh? It's supper time, grandpa. What's for supper? Lamb. Huh? Lamb. Jam. I don't want no jam. No, grandpa, not jam. Lamb. Just sit down, grandpa. Well, give me some of it. They ripped him off a lamb's leg. He began to chew on it and they began to talk. Glory to God, we're leaving here in the morning. We're going out of here in the morning. There's not, we're not leaving a hoof behind. God's gave us a pillar of fire. God's gave us a prophet. God's gave us an exodus. Hello. Hallelujah. We're going out of here. We are going out of here. Grandpa said, huh? What'd you say? We're leaving in the morning, Grandpa. Just keep eating. He just kept eating on that lamb. Oh, no teeth, just trying to gum it out, you know, trying to eat on it. And they just kept talking to, oh, God, we're leaving here in the morning. Glory to God. God's done a great thing for us. I'm so excited. I'm so on fire. We're leaving here in the morning.
Amen.
Grandma kept eating on that lamb. And they kept talking about leaving. Yes, sir, we're taking our carts. We're taking our cows. We're taking our dogs. We're taking our children. We're even taking our wives. We're taking everything. We are leaving here in the morning. Grandpa been eating on that lamb. He raises up and says, let's go. Oh, I'm having a good time. You say, that's nonsense. Hey, the Bible said when they left Egypt, there was not a feeble one among them. Hallelujah. Oh, Grandpa went out there pushing the cart. Let's go, boys. We're more than able. I don't know about you, but there's something inside of me tonight that's saying we are more than able to take the land. Amen. Do you love him? This widow woman began to take of this meal. She began to take of this oil. She began to grow strong. She began to look healthy. She'd go down to the market. Her cheeks would be rosy. Her hair would be shiny. Is that Maybelline? No. No, that's not. Is that some kind of, I don't know anything about that stuff, but is that kind of, no. Are you putting something on your face? Did you get something off of eBay? No. Well, you look so healthy. You know, everybody else, you know, she's going through the village because she was eating, brother. She's eating. God's provided food. She's just dancing through the streets. Good morning. God bless you. Hallelujah. How you doing? Everybody else, rah, rah, rah. Good morning. Shut, move on. Everybody grumpy, grouchy, not her. Not her. Amen. So when you come in here grouchy, I know what you've been feeding on. She was so happy. Why can't Christians be happy? Smile for a while. Give your face a rest. You know, in this lazy age of Laodicea, when nobody wants to do nothing except mow their yard on Sunday. Never did understand that. In this age, when it takes more muscles to frown than it does smile, you figure we'd smile because it's easier. People come to church. You love the Lord? You happy? Glad to be here? Same expression. But I don't know about you, friends, but I believe we've got something to be happy about. Huh? Others are getting weak. Not her. Not her. Huh? Others was dragging in and couldn't raise her hand. Oh, God, I can hardly get my head up. I'm so weak. Not her. You know why? She was feeding off God's provided way. Oh, brother, sister, we got a meal barrel this evening, ordained of God to sustain us in this time of famine, in this time of drought. Oh, the more we eat, the more it's changing us. Just keep eating. Just keep eating. Just keep smiling and keep eating. Be happy. We are eating ourselves into a body change. You know, I used to work with a doctor, a plastic surgeon, and he would do the banding of the stomach to help people lose weight. And he did a presentation, a slideshow presentation, and I went with him to address it to a group of people in an auditorium with a screen. And so the first thing he pops up on the screen is a coffin. And on the words it says this: America is digging their grave with their teeth. The problem of obesity in America. That was his presentation. And he was saying America is actually killing herself by the things they eat. And we know that's true. Hybrid food and all that, we know. Huh? She said, America are digging their grave with their teeth. But I'm so happy to say this afternoon, there is a group of people in America, we're not eating ourselves into a grave. We're eating ourselves out of the grave, amen. We are eating ourselves because we're not feasting on some man's ideal. We are feasting on the unfailing word body of the Son of Man ministry. Christ has proved himself alive, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Feasting on the manna from above, seeing the hand of God made manifest, proving the promises of this day. Do you love him? Amen. What does the meal represent? It represents Christ. The meal barrel represents Christ. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do you love him? Amen. The bread of life today the children eat on follows the message of God. It sustains them during a time of drought. Amen. Amen. If he stood in our presence right now, what would Jesus do? Right. He would do the same thing he done when he was here. Right. Amen. Proving himself the same. Right. Right. Amen. Amen. The bride is a part of the husband, and the church is the same as Christ. Glory. The works I do shall you do also. Amen. It is the work that done it. See, it's the word that done it. He told us these things that he did, that we would do also. Think of it, friends. In the time of famine, there was a Gentile with a meal barrel that had the blessing of Elijah on it. And every time it would go down, God would fill it back up. It would be restored back. Amen. Do you love him? So is it today, Father. The church, the true believer, the body of believers has access to the food, spiritual food, that the nominals know nothing about. The world knows nothing of this food, Father. But your church, your people, the bride of your Son loves it. We have access to the healing of our bodies when the doctor says fail. We have access to this. It's one of the foods of God that he gave to his church. For what did he say? Healing is the children's bread. Is that right, friends? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He gave his church these promises. He promised it for the last day for his believing children. Help us to be believing children, Father. For all things are possible to the believer. All things are possible to the believer. I'm sorry I kept you so long. I'm normally not a long-winded preacher. I know you don't believe that, but it's the truth. But may God richly bless you, friends. What a privilege it is to know in this time of famine, when the world has gone absolutely insane, that we are a people sitting in our right minds, feasting off manna, heavenly food and spiritual food in due season. Everything we have need of is in the barrel. You need joy? Reach in the barrel. You need healing? Reach in the barrel. Need forgiveness? Reach in the barrel. Need restoration? Reach in the barrel. Need strength? It's in the barrel. Everything we have need of, God has provided in the meal barrel. What is the meal barrel? It's Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. We can drink all we want to drink. We can eat all we want to eat. You will never exhaust this fountain. Water. Water in a time of famine. Food in the time of famine. What a privilege it is, friends. You know, some of you say here, I'm closing up. I know I am. Brother comes, sister comes, whoever comes to come to the instruments. Some of you sit here year after year. You have never took advantage of what God's provided for you. I read a story one time. Perhaps you've heard the story. That a man read about diamonds. And the diamonds, so reading this story about diamonds, it so moved the man that he sold everything he had. He sold his land, he sold his farm, he sold everything that he had to go out and search for these diamonds. He lost his wife, he lost his children, he lost his position in the community. And when he was an old man, he died a beggar. He died on the streets a beggar. But he never found one diamond. But the man who bought his farm was out plowing in the backyard. And he struck a rock. And when he pulled that rock up out of the ground, it was a diamond. And the biggest diamond mine in South Africa was on the man's property. He had it all along. Some of you young people, you rebel. You move away. You won't come under the headship of this message. You think you can go out there and find something in the world to sustain you. I tell you, in the name of the Lord, there's nothing out there that will sustain you. We play around on God. We drag in on God. But let me tell you, there is nothing out there. There's no Republican Party. There's no Democrat Party. There's no Socialist Party. There is nothing that can turn this nation around. She's gone, friends. It's finished. The prophet of God said, I don't even pray for her anymore. That was 2 years before I was ever born. And I'll be 56 years old next week. And this nation, before I was ever born, had turned its back on God, friends. Now they've took God out of schools. Now they're wanting to take him off our money. They want to take him. Is that right, friends? This nation is gone. Listen to me, young people. The thing that you think you need, a bigger job, bigger jobs, more money. More money is a bigger car. Bigger car, new boat, new house, more problems. That's right. That's right. The more toys you get, the more it takes to keep up with them. Then the next thing you know, you're working two jobs. Next thing you know, your family's gone. There's nothing out there. I'm not against good jobs. I'm not against good houses. I'm not against none of that. But that's not our God, friends. That's not our God. But what a blessed people we are this afternoon. And I was thinking, coming down the road, and I'm sorry, but Sam will forgive me, but just coming down the road this morning, I was thinking, what a blessed people we are. I thought, man, this place is way out here in the country. But way out here in the country of Georgia, there's a meal barrel. There's a meal barrel. Whatever we have need of, brother, there's healing in that meal barrel. There's restoration of our marriages in that meal barrel. There's joy. There's peace. There's happiness. Amen. It's all in the meal barrel. Whatever you have need of tonight, why don't you just reach into that barrel and pull it out. And eat it. You see, Elijah would have died also. He laid by that water. If he had not leaned over and took a drink of it, he would have died with the rest of them in the famine. It's not enough just to be here. We got to take it in. We got to be a part of it. The very thing that you need, young people, the very thing that you need, brother, the very thing that you need, sister, is right here with us now. What a great thing God has done for us. Let's bow our heads. God bless you richly. Heavenly Father, God, I apologize to you people for keeping them for so long, Lord. Just a lovely group to speak to, God. But Lord, these things, I believe, Lord. I believe it's true, God. Lord, I know that whatever we have need of today, it's right here. There's one in our midst now who has revealed itself to be the same yesterday, today, and forever. And whatever we have need of, Lord, is in the barrel. May we, by faith today, just reach into the barrel. You need healing? Just reach into the barrel. You need joy? Reach into the barrel. You need happiness? Reach into the barrel. You need forgiveness, it's in the barrel. Need the Holy Ghost, it's in the everything we have need of. God has provided for us. He even said rapturing faith lies in the message. Everything we have need of, friends, it's right here with us now. And all we have to do is eat our way into a body change. Lord, when I was in Trinidad a few years ago, and how you moved in that service down there and those folks there in the altar, God, cried and wept until the whole floor was wet with their tears. And one of the sisters went home after the meeting and her husband, he didn't come. He's in a hateful mood and she's in there singing, I'm happy today, so happy today, since Jesus has taken my sins away. She said, he yelled from the living room and said, woman, what are you so happy about? And she said, I told him, why don't you come to church tomorrow night and find out. Oh God, this message makes us so happy, Lord. May you move upon your children tonight, God. How many of you has a need tonight? You believe God will hear your prayer. Yes, maybe you're sick. Maybe the doctors give you a bad report. I hardly know any of you, friends, but high blood, low blood, no blood, it means nothing to God. Our God is able, friends. Amen. My daughter today is 23-year-old. Well, after the accident, when she's about 6-year-old, she come running through the house one day. After she'd been blind and in a wheelchair that had to support her whole body. She had no control over her body. And she come running through the house and inspiration. I jumped up and I grabbed a pencil and I just began to write. Looking at you now, it's hard to realize that one day you could not walk or see me with your eyes. But the God above who loves us shows how much he cares. For in our desperate hour, he answered our prayer. And when I see you, I see his love. And when I touch your smiling face, I feel his amazing grace. To see you jump and run, to see you laugh and play. When I see you, Jessica, I see God's grace. Oh, God, it's grace, Lord. Grace to a dying generation that you, Lord, would provide for us food for a body change, Lord. May we humbly tonight receive it, Lord, and acknowledge it. May your spirit move upon your children, Lord. You see their needs tonight, God. I ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, may your spirit just move for them just now. How many of you has a need tonight? If you just stand to your feet quickly, and we'll just get out of the way. But if you just stand to your feet, say, I have a need tonight, Brother Darrell, but I believe there's a meal barrel here. I believe there's a way provided here for me tonight. I believe there's healing. I believe there's joy. I believe there's forgiveness. I believe everything that I have need of, I can receive it right here tonight. No need to go looking anywhere else, friends. It's right here, right now. This is where you're at. God has placed us here by a divine act. He has orchestrated this moment in time. And while we're here in his presence, let's take advantage of it tonight. tonight. Whatever you have need of, I just wonder if you just stand to your feet, just raise your hands to God, and in your own way, brother to brother, sister to sister, just lay your hands on one another, a husband to wife, brother to brother, sister to sister, just lay your hands on one another now, and just pray for the person that you got your hand on. Just pray that tonight that they can reach up and grab it by faith and receive of that meal barrel what they have need of tonight. Heavenly Father, we don't see all things, but we do see Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord God, this evening, in the name of Jesus, by the same anointing that raised up Jessica and gave her back to me, may that same anointing tonight move upon these needs, dear God, I pray. Lord, there be great needs here, but there's not one here greater than you. So we'll take your word over every symptom, God. Lord, we don't base it on sensation. We don't base it on emotion, but we base it simply on the word of God because you said so. Oh, God, let that perfect faith explode into our hearts tonight, Lord, and receive that which you've provided for us in the name of Jesus Christ. Satan, I adjure thee by God tonight. You're defeated. Come out of the people in the name of Jesus Christ for the glory of God. We stand as God's ambassadors. We stand tonight as God's servants. And in the name of Jesus Christ, we claim our God-given right as sons of the seed of Abraham to receive the blessed promise of God's word. I'm healed by his stripes. I'm forgiven by the shedding of his blood. Amen. And I'm filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Oh God, I receive it in the name of Jesus Christ because the word of God said so, Lord. These signs shall follow them that believe. And Lord, we believe tonight. Grant it, I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, do you love him tonight? Oh, let's just raise our hands now. Let's just sing it with all of our hearts. I love him because he first loved me. Go ahead, brother, sing it for us tonight.
I love him.
Handkerchief, okay? I'm nothing, but he's everything. I want you to take this and put it under your pillow, okay? We just believe that God just does something wonderful for you. Heavenly Father, tonight, Lord, you see my brother's need, God. But Lord, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. I pray tonight, oh Father God, may your spirit move for our brother, God. Meet his need tonight, God. May the kidneys start functioning for thy glory, we pray. God, we ask these things because we believe you're able, Lord. Our problems may be big, but our God is bigger, Lord. And we look to you tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. May it be according to our faith, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Receive you tonight. Receive your joy. Up into the meal barrel. Reach into the meal barrel tonight. Receive what you have need of. Hallelujah. God bless you richly. Amen.
Because he first loved me and purchased my salvation.
Soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. sing that song for us? Or can we worship him just for a second? So, Brother Darrell, it's after 4 o'clock. I know I got to drive home, too, but that's all right. I feel good tonight. Do you love him? Let's just sing soon. It's very soon. I am going to see the King. Amen. Sing it for us, brother.
Very soon we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon we are going to see the King. Oh, soon and very soon we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King.
There'll be no
more very soon we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon we are going to see the King. We are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Anybody have a need, and just like to come, let our brother pray with you.
We are going to see the King. Oh, soon and very soon we are going to see the King.
Just come and let's see.
Oh, soon and very soon,
you have a great message.
We are
going to see the King.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King.
Can you believe that?
Soon and very soon, we are going
to come and see if he's real.
Soon and
you don't know that God is your Savior.
We are going to see.
Come and see.
Hallelujah.
As a child of God, in the name of Jesus Christ, leaving Satan for the glory of God tonight. You're not welcome here in the name of Jesus.
Amen. We are going to see the King.
Amen.
Do you know him?
Hallelujah.
Do you know him as your Savior? Do you know him as King?
And very soon, we're going to see the King. Amen. Did you enjoy the message?
Amen.
Let's give our brother a good hand. You know, I was thinking while he was ministering, it said that he prepared a widow woman to take care of him. Why did he say widow woman? Her old husband, the prophet said, died in the drought. She wouldn't have been a widow woman if he hadn't provided it. Her old husband died in the drought. I just ask you, and I question, is our whole husband, them old denominations, them old things, our own thoughts and ideas, are they still alive in our hearts and lives? We've had a great drought across the land for many, many years. And that is the time for the husband to be put away. So then, has it happened? Or do we still have just our own talks and ways about it? Make sure you tell our brother how much you appreciate him. Appreciate him coming down and ministering for us, and really enjoyed the message, enjoyed having everybody here. But Mike back there, we didn't see him till we done got up here this morning, and I looked back there and sees an old friend of us. I reckon he's been here before, but if he hadn't, we always say welcome. But then you come two times, he's part of us, because that's just our beings and our doings, right? Amen. So just make sure you tell our brother how much you appreciate the message. We believe it, and we thank God for it, right? Let's dismiss together. Oh, yeah. All right. We are the festival coming up, okay? The October festival. The ones that's going to have anything to do with any of the doings needs to meet with Wade downstairs back in the Sunday school room there, and for a few minutes to decide what everything's going to be done. Now, most of you know what we done last year. You know what you done. So just expecting you to do the same thing this time. Make the and do the games and the things. We appreciate it. Appreciate all the work and all the things that the people do to provide everything and doing it and all like that. And we'll be having our October festival together. And just, we thank you. So you just go downstairs and find out, you know, what you need to do. If anything new or anything you can come up with, new ideas, we're always open because we believe it, right? Amen. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your grace and your love unto us this day. Thank you for our brother coming to speak unto us. We really appreciate him coming and pouring out his heart unto us about how he thinks about you. And when we hear somebody talking about our daddy, then we enjoy that, Lord, because that's who truly you are. So we thank you, and we ask you to just bless our brother, and Lord, be with him as he travels home this afternoon, and give him, Lord, of your grace and love and traveling mercy to be able to travel on and be with his family. We love you, and we thank you. We commit everything to you. May all the people be have a safe journey home, and all things be well. And we just commit everything to you now in Jesus' name. Amen. If you want to listen to the message, he has the things, you know, it's on the internet. And all, and Brother Joe made me some there the other day, if you want to, of the testimony of Brother Darrell. I thoroughly encourage you to, because he didn't get to tell you a lot of what happened and all like that, about the child and how that it was blind and how the different things. And they told him it wouldn't go to school. They told him it wouldn't walk. They told him it'd never see. They told him all things from the doctor, but they held on. And God, come on. So I'm sure, you know, if you want to watch it, it's on the internet. Okay, you're dismissed, amen.
I have a see you.